was criticized for my films being too visual, and I'm going, I'm not doing a radio play, I'm doing a movie, dude. And I then realized it's actually a tremendous advantage, because I think not just in the words, but I think also in parallel with the visual essay of what's going to happen.
The Martian story is set in the very near future, 6-7 years in the future. We consulted with both JPL and NASA. JPL in Pasadena, California, does the unmanned missions, like the Curiosity probe, Pathfinder, Opportunity Spirit, and also with the Johnson Space Center in Houston, who do manned missions and currently are working on the Orion Mars project, which is set for, I believe, their first flight will be in 2020. And so the project engineers on both of those groups were kind enough to meet with me and consult with me and offer advice and information.
Even the science fiction shouldn't look like science fiction, it should look like what it is. That's what I always liked about 2001, even though in its fantastic view of the future, it felt real.
Ridley Scott called NASA headquarters, wanting to get some expertise to help him design and be part of the consulting on his film. The first tour we did was at Johnson Space Center. Art Max showed up, you know, one of Ridley's fabulous designers. We just had a wonderful time that whole day going around JSC, going into what space station looks like. We have mock-ups of everything that we put into space on the ground so that we can test things and we know what the astronauts are actually looking at and doing.
A lot of what our mothership, the Hermes, were based on their engineers' schematics and concepts for future interplanetary vehicles to bring both vehicles and equipment, habitat and crew to the surface of Mars in 2020 and onward. So we had tried to adjust those ideas to something that was closer to, say, the International Space Station technology, but pushing the envelope a bit further out into the future with a series of interlocking modules that connect together in a chain and are placed in order of functionality in an arrangement that, with consultation with the scientist who was our advisor, Rudy Schmidt from the European Space Agency, gave us a lot of advice about where things would go, the proper placing of the different modules in relationship to each other, plus some of our own imagination to give it some more style, which they encouraged us to do.
When I was invited to help here, I was a bit skeptical because I thought this is one of these films where pure magic happens and people survive due to magic. Then the first thing is I ordered this book, I read it, and I was really amazed by the story because, of course, there are a few things in it which are not completely in line with physics and nature on Mars. For instance, the sandstorm in the beginning.
In a sense, it's correct. The storm is dangerous.
Yes. For what reasons?
It carries dust. Very, very small particle. The storm is something like cigarette smoke.
They described it to me at NASA as a powder puff on your face.
Yeah, something like that.
But overall, I think 95% of the film is such that you could think, yeah, it could be that way.
Only a few experts will smile. And
yeah.
More.
Yeah, exactly. We'd like it to be correct as possible.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, but of course, this is 30, 40, 50 years from now.
Oh, no, only 10. Oh, you mean in reality?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we're pushing things along.
Yeah, no, therefore nobody can argue that this is not correct or something, because this is all new technology.
It's probably something that NASA engineers will recognize and see, you know, that this ship could fly and function on a prolonged interplanetary journey. And also science fiction fans will enjoy from a level of pure aesthetic.
I think one of their biggest problems is on such a long journey, having no gravity. And therefore, the idea of creating a gravitational center to the ship would be desirable.
On long missions, of course, it's even more critical. And so the idea is already existing since long to rotate certain pieces of a spaceship. And in this case, on Hermes, they call it a gravity wheel. That's nothing else than a ring in which astronauts can work or live or sleep. And that ring is rotating, and by rotating, it creates centrifugal force. That's de facto simulating a gravity. The astronauts really feel that force, and their muscles have to work against that force.
Apparently, when you're spinning at the outer rim, you have to reach a speed of about 5 miles an hour, and you have gravity. So how do you get to the wheel? The wheel has spokes. The center of the wheel, as it's going round and the spokes are doing that, you've got no gravity. As you enter the wheel, you're spinning into a trajectory of 1 mile an hour, two, three, four. By the time you get to the bottom, you're walking.
There was a lot of discussion about how to achieve a rotational set with curvature. After watching the sequence in 2001, which is very famous for its Ferris wheel set, we worked out that with our technology of today, the CGI technology, we don't have to go 360 degrees, we can go 18 degrees. And by putting the set on a platform of steel and just gimballing it, it can rock through 18 degrees either way. You get enough movement which can be embellished by the background moving rather than the set moving entirely.
In Budapest, in the Korda studios, where they have the largest stage in the world, stage six, and we decided that we could actually do an exterior Mars on the stage, as it was so big and so high that you could light it for an exterior and control everything.
In creating the Martian surface, we've used about 4,000 tons of different materials to get to that color. There's about three or four different materials which we've mixed by machine and then laid in the studio, in the stage rather, here, with a mixture of machine and by hand.
When we went to the Johnson Space Center, they have a research hab standing there, which they're doing studies on, designed for one person currently. But we took a lot of notes out of the layout and the material usage and the systems. But we have six astronauts, so we had to expand the scale of it somewhat. We added a large dome-shaped habitation.
They're round houses, they're like flat loaves of bread, and which is a very thick, protective double skin, outside as strong as Velcro. Two airlocks, a central community area, which will have kitchen, laboratories, a short corridor through a sealed area to shared bedroom spaces.
All the issues that were raised by the NASA engineers, we've tried to accommodate into the design.
I'm very primitive. I still storyboard everything myself. It's like a fast page reminder. Quite accurate, quite efficient. By doing that, it means you separate yourself from into your own mind, where it's a bit like rewriting the visual essay on parallel with the spoken essay. Because the digital designers today, with Arthur, and I'm always involved in everything, we literally fundamentally design everything here. They're like colored visuals, like photographs. Literally, they are photographs.
Our rover design is kind of something all terrain based on agricultural vehicle with all-wheel steering and all-wheel suspension. So it's high above the ground. We thought this was an advantage to navigating the difficult terrain of Mars.
I went with a basic vehicle that has no axle. There's no traditional axle because of the ground, so the wheels need to be able to do this independently. So I went with a very modern, high-tech piece of farm equipment. We give them to my engineering geniuses, who then reconverted and put on top the newly designed cab.
The first build stage is the Hungarian Paridakar team, who basically spend 10 hours a day driving across deserts at breakneck speeds. They know how to build vehicles like this. They're going to construct the chassis and the front cab section. We do all of the dressing, all of the makes, and we take that bare bone structure and we make it NASA.
It's got sort of slight insect pod head sticking out. Its suspension is not just straight out for a reason. You know, we kinked it and put a little knuckle in the end because it's like the hands and the arms of an insect, you know, and it's got that look about it. It's slightly lunging forward with its head down, ready to sort of pounce. There are some influences of the NASA prototype rovers that have gone into that, just to how that, all the windows go into it and sink back into the bodywork. We can't put a NASA logo on anything. We have to get permission. We've been sending them designs to approve, and when they approve it, we can stick the NASA logo on the side. We're going for an engineering-based design, so it's form follows function, really. So, and that's how NASA stuff looks like. The primary thing it's got to do is work. You know, everything that they do is engineering-based, and it's got that look about it. So we've tried to get the same look here.
Always trying to be technically accurate, if I can, and with Arthur. Everything, the suits have got to work, they've got to make sense.
That's what's interesting about The Martian, because it's close to where we're going in the next couple of decades with space exploration. And with consultation with, you know, people who are actually planning it, who are guiding us, not, you know, constraining us, but guiding us. Hopefully we've come up with, you know, a blend that makes sense and also inspires.